I am your host, Thabo Kancube. Today on Live Talk, we are discussing the impact of the Mandela Washington Fellowship as it celebrates its 10th anniversary. The Mandela Washington Fellowship for Young African Leaders is the flagship program of the Young African Leaders Initiative, YALI, established in 2014 by then US President Barack Obama.
You are the best student.
Yes!
Wow!
Africa!
A round of applause for you!
Wow!
Mandela Washington Fellows 2024. Congratulations for the far that you have come.
Wow! Wow! Think of the energy in this room. Takes me back to my fellowship experience.
It is what happens when you stay 6 weeks without ugali.
Wow.
6 weeks without fufu.
Wow.
6 weeks without pap.
Yes.
6 weeks without chicken domoda.
Yes. And 6 weeks without meat. Meat from the continent.
To discuss this issue, we are joined in the studio by Tatenda Muzangwa, Managing Director of Choto Renewable Energy. Welcome to the program.
Thank you very much.
We are also joined on the phone by Mr. Njabulo Michael Sandawana of Linkwire Media Tech News. He is the co-founder. Welcome to the program.
Thank you so much.
Thank you. Thank you. We will honor ladies. We'll start with you, Tatenda. Tell us about your experiences during the fellowship. You've been here 6 weeks. How has it been?
Oh, it's been wonderful. My experience has been absolutely wonderful. I can't even put it to words. It's been full of events. We've been going through a lot of training. We have done a lot of field trips, and we've done a lot of hospitality visits. For me, that is probably the highlight, to know and to see how people here are so friendly and welcoming. So it's been absolutely amazing. So much to learn.
Wow, that's a good experience. Mr. Sandawana, when uhlelo lolu ulubone njani bekunjani ulapha okwamaviki ay
and sifundo kakhulu in terms of how to better run our businesses loku network nje labanye abahlali ba America labanye ama business people from various places around the African continent. So bekuhle kakhulu ukufunda lokwazana labanye abantu.
Into ngathi ikumangalisile kakhulu ngalesi sikhathi useMelika, into ngathi ungayichazela abantu ukuthi ngokokuqala usiba le experience enjalo ikuyini?
Okokuqala ukuthi kuyachisa lapho bengingayexpect ukuthi kuzachisa so. Kuyachisa kakhulu kodwa into enye engiyifundileyo yikuthi abantu baya i-support esiyitholileyo from abantu abalapha isimangalise kakhulu and batshengisa ukuba interested or ukuthanda izinto esizenzayo back home and bafuna ukusisapota. So bekuyinto engiyithabele yona leyo.
Yeah, hayi, siyabonga kakhulu. Kukhanya beku yisikhathi esokufunda izinto eziningi kakhulu. Tatenda, coming back to you, what are some of the biggest takeaways that you will be taking home back to Zimbabwe? Zvinhu zvaunoti kana wava kudzokera mumusha ungada kuimplementa zvawaona kuno zvisipo kuZimbabwe?
All right. I think my biggest takeaway is probably the power of, networking and making building lasting relationships. For me, that's one of the things that I learned the most here. And also, I've got more confidence because one of the things that I learned when I came here, I was like so excited that going to America, we're going to learn a lot, which we did. But don't get me wrong, I really, really appreciate it. But I've also grown to be confident of what we have, the resources that we have, and how we can utilize it. Most of the times we're full of excuses of saying, oh, I need funding, I need this. But there are always ways to go about your business, right? Look for the minimum viable, product. So for me, I've learned that it's okay. We have the resources, so we need to get it done and to have more confidence with what we have. Because there are farmers here, for example, I was at Purdue University. It's more agricultural than anything else. So we got to visit farmers. And some of the farmers were like, Zimbabweans, what are you doing here? We're like, we're here to learn. And they're like, no, we came to Zimbabwe to learn from you. So it's just gaining more confidence and just really, leveraging from networks that are around us while we are, Mandela fellows.
Yeah. Wow, that sounds exciting. Mjabulo, your biggest takeaway is that you will take back home, looking at the work that you do, comparing to others who are doing the same work in other countries in Africa as well as here in the U.S., what would you say you learned from them that you would want to also replicate back home?
So there are several lessons that I can expound on. But I think one of the most interesting things for me was to witness the power of collaboration. Mm-hmm. So I think that's something that has been impactful in my experience to understand. And also just to echo what Tatina said, that just being able to actually, do things and not make excuses for why you're not doing things. So I think that has been the biggest takeaway, going out there and getting things done. So I think that's the same energy that I'll take back to me to Zimbabwe to get things done.
Thank you so much. Tatenda, we realize that we have a crisis in Zimbabwe when it comes to power generation. This year only, we have a situation here kuti Kariba haina mvura because of the drought. And that's a situation irikusia vanhu going for hours without electricity. And you've come here, you've learned. What do you think are some of the things that you can implement in Zimbabwe to remedy the situation, because you will realize that this is not a crisis that started last year or this year, but it has been ongoing. Mm-hmm. What do you think should be done, and what are some of the ways that you have learned here that you think can be implemented back home?
All right. So as the founder of Choto Renewable Energy Company, right, I am passionate about renewable energy, and I'm passionate about working on alternative energy, solutions, right? So from this experience, right, and also knowing what is happening in Zimbabwe, I am more confident. I want to contribute towards renewable energy. So far I've been working on biomass briquettes, which is an alternative product, right? So because of the power outages, all right, and the exorbitant fuel prices, the locals had resorted to unsustainable forms of energy like illegal charcoal, right? So there's a lot of illegal charcoal production. So I want to come in and say, hey, there is a legal form of charcoal, if I may call it that, a biomass briquette, which is produced from biomass, right, like agricultural waste, that we can bring to the product, to the public for use, especially targeting poultry farmers and targeting in the future tobacco farmers. We also want to dwell in that. So I want to contribute to the solution as far as energy is concerned. And also Choto will also have a Choto Solar division, whereby we also do residential solar installations to help our local community. Thank you.
Thank you. Sandawana, we have a situation in Zimbabwe where it's not easy to do business. The economy is not at its best. And as someone who is in business, you look at business development. What are some of the things that you say they've changed your perspective when you look at how you have been doing things back in Zimbabwe, and now that you have gone through this training, what do you think are some of the things that you are going to change when you get back home?
Yeah, thank you. So I think for me, like I mentioned, my biggest takeaways was I noticed how, people collaborate, and I think that exposure will allow me to also try to you know, have a mindset shift in how I run my business back home and also how I support other local businesses. Because I think that, you know, the success of one company or one brand is a sort of universal success for all of us. So I think one thing that I'll do differently is to definitely support more local owned products on sort of a personal capacity, because I've seen the importance of that, of building that kind of confidence in Zimbabwean businesses and in Zimbabwean brands. So that's something that I think I would want to do once I get back home, and do more of, rather. Yeah.
Thank you, Sandawana. As we conclude this segment, any last words from you, Njabulo?
I think my, first of all, I think I'm grateful for the opportunity to come here and I'm very excited about taking back home some of the learnings and some of the networks that I've been able to build here to try and build a better sustainable future for not only our country but our continent. But also, I would like to encourage anyone that wants to join or wants to apply for the Mandela Fellowship to go for it, because it's definitely a life-changing opportunity. In my case, it helped me become a better business person and also just get to interact with a lot of people that are in the same field, or maybe not in the same field, but are also trying to, you know, have the same vision in terms of building a sustainable future for our continent and different countries within our region.
Thank you so much, Mr. Njabulo, Michael Sandawana, for appearing on our program. While we wait for our next guests, who are also going to be joining over the phone, let's take a look at what is happening in Venezuela. Large numbers of Venezuelans took part in Sunday's presidential election, whose process has drawn scrutiny, although some Venezuelans have taken to the streets to protest the results. Others do not dispute them. Meanwhile, the international community is calling for an independent verification of the vote. VOA's Celia Mendoza reports from the State Department here in Washington, D.C.
Protests erupted in Venezuela hours after the National Electoral Council, which is loyal to the ruling party, declared incumbent President Nicolas Maduro the winner of Sunday's election.
Recibo esta credencial.
I receive this credential, constitutional and legal, from the authority in charge of electoral matters in Venezuela, the sovereign electoral power of Venezuela, which has issued a ruling that I accept humbly.
National Electoral Council President Elvis Amoroso said that Maduro received 51% of the vote and that Edmundo González Urrutia received 44%. González became the candidate after the government barred opposition leader Maria Corina Machado from running.
Edmundo González Urrutia got 70% of the votes in this election, and Nicolas Maduro received 30% of the votes.
Machado says her results are based on tallies the opposition campaign received from representatives stationed at about 40% of ballot boxes. The claims of election irregularity have drawn attention from the international community, including U.S. Secretary of State Antony Blinken, who expressed his concerns about the validity of the results Monday during his visit to Tokyo.
It's critical that every vote be counted fairly and transparently, that election officials immediately share information with the opposition and independent observers without delay, and that the electoral authorities publish the detailed tabulation of votes.
In a letter, Argentina, Costa Rica, Ecuador, Guatemala, Paraguay, Peru, the Dominican Republic, and Uruguay shared their profound concern about the vote and requested an urgent meeting before the Organization of American States. But one analyst says internal, not external, pressures may be needed to effect change.
And I think change, if it happens, is going to have to come within Venezuela rather than from abroad. And, you know, I don't think this is over just yet. Maduro doesn't rule alone. Both he and key figures in his inner circle know that he's not going to be able to govern a country in flames.
On Monday, Venezuelan Attorney General Tarek William Saab accused Machado and other opposition members of attempting to hack of the country's electoral system. No evidence has been provided.
I think we're going to see greater and greater repression in the next few days in Venezuela. So far, we've already seen attacks against Maria Corina's campaign and threats against her person in recent months. And I think the government's likely to escalate that.
On Monday, Panama's president, José Raúl Mulino, announced a break with Venezuela.
El gobierno de Panamá anuncia el retiro del personal diplomático de Venezuela.
The Panamanian government announced the withdrawal of diplomatic personnel from Venezuela and the suspension of diplomatic relations until a complete review of the minutes and the computer system of the vote count is carried out.
Que permitan conocer la genuina voluntad popular.
Bolivia, Honduras, China, Cuba, Iran, and Russia have recognized Maduro's victory. But Ramsey notes that other nations in the region are less complacent towards the president.
We're seeing governments in Latin America start to recognize that this is not a left-right issue. This is about democracy or dictatorship.
Ramsey says the protests in Venezuela now are just a drop in the bucket compared to what's to come. Celia Mendoza, VOA News, State Department.
For those that have just joined us, please note that we are streaming live on our Facebook pages, VOA Shona, VOA Studio 7, and VOA Ndebele. We are also live on YouTube, VOA Zimbabwe. As we continue to focus on the 2024 Yali Mandela Washington Fellowship, which is coming to an end here in Washington, D.C., with a summit that is being attended by 700 brilliant minds from different African countries. We also have on the phone Ms. Chiedza Mlingwa, a research specialist at the Zimbabwe Human Rights NGO Forum. Welcome to the program, Chiedza.
Hi, and thank you for having me.
We also have on the line Ms. Victoria Gazi, of the founder and managing director of Vicky Doman Investments. Welcome to the program.
Thank you so much. Thank you for having me.
Yes, we'll start with you, Victoria. Looking at the experience that you have had here in the U.S., tell us about that experience and how it's comparative to your work that you do back home. How different is it? How different do people handle themselves here?
I think... Well, we have always, from the beginning, tried to place ourselves at an international standard level in all our operations. And the experience here has actually just opened my eyes that we are on the right track. We are operating the right way as we are working towards always maintaining good quality products as well as professionalism in all our services. So I have four businesses, but the main business that brought me here is the brick manufacturing business. And I did have a lot of opportunity to interact with various people in the construction sector here in the U.S. And it's been eye-opening as well. And it's given us ideas of more products that we could possibly introduce upon return to Zimbabwe.
Thank you so much, Ms. Gazi. Coming to you, Ms. Mlingwa, looking at the type of work that you do, which is something to do with human rights, contrasting Zimbabwe and the U.S., what are some of the things that you think you would want to implement when going back home? And how easy do you think it will be to make such a change? You know, there are situations where you see a very good thing happening and then you look at where our country is and how you can move from where things are. How easy do you think it's going to be to implement some of these changes?
Thank you for that question. So, you know, one of the things that had a profound effect on me was attending the 4th of July celebrations. And I was at the presidential precinct undergoing the leadership in civic engagement track. And we spent our 4th of July at Colonial Williamsburg, which is really where of American democracy, you know, really began. And for me, it was something that really impacted hugely on me to see such a, you know, proud and loud display of, you know, American patriotism. And the reason why it's really hit me that hard is that in as much as we have our own independence celebrations back home, most citizens do not resonate anymore with the day, with the celebrations. They now have a resigned, fatalistic attitude and outlook to the socioeconomic challenges that the country is facing. And they therefore do not, they are mostly in survival mode. They therefore do not connect, you know, with that aspect of the country. They do not feel independent. They do not see the need to take part in the celebrations. We are a highly polarized society. So for me, this is something that I would love to see, cohesion. Yeah. For us as a country, you know, to see that unity, to see a country that takes pride, you know, citizens that feel at one, you know, and not have so much of that polarization. So it's not going to be easy, you know. This is not work that can be implemented or attained or achieved overnight. But that is the first thing that I would love to take back home with me, just as an attitude mindset, I think. And secondly, the other thing that I noticed is that we, you know, we look at America as a paragon of democracy. We're at the home, at the homes of three former founding fathers, American founding fathers. We went to Thomas Jefferson's Monticello. We were at James Madison's Montpelier. We were at James Monroe's Highland. And, you know, we... particularly at Montpelier, this is where we actually were fully invested in constitution building. We did a constitution building simulation, and we got to really tour these estates and see what inspired these founding fathers as they came up with this foundational progressive document. And this one, I mean, this has been hundreds of years ago, and they were very young men when they did this, already thinking about a document that, you know, comprises a Bill of Rights. And that same document is the one that has influenced so many constitutions across the world. We have borrowed so much from, you know, in terms of principles of democracy from that very same document across the world. So to me, this says that, you know, there really is still a lot of work that has to be done in terms of the actual implementation of, you know, when we speak of fundamental rights and freedoms in Zimbabwe. I know America is currently going through its own challenges right now, but one notable thing is that it's got institutions, and its institutions that buttress democracy, they work, you know, they are there to make sure that actual democracy is at play. So what we have to see is working institutions of democracy in Zimbabwe.
Thank you, Mr. Mlingwa. Before we let you go there, briefly tell us, do you think your experience here in the U.S. will empower others as well, or it's mostly just the change of attitude for you only?
So it really, for me already, I'm starting to see the fruits. So, you know, when we are here, we are not just representing ourselves. We are representing people who come from low marginalized or low income households of marginalized communities, mm-hmm. who would never think or believe that, you know, you could be walking in the streets of Washington, D.C. all the way as a child from a low-income household in Africa, Zimbabwe, for that matter. So already right now, I am seeing the fruits. A lot of the young girls who are seeing me occupying these spaces, they feel that edge and drive to say, I see myself in her. I can make it too. I can walk in that same path as well. This is not, you know, leadership. You don't need to have a particular type of education. Mm-hmm. You don't need to come from a particular type of background in order to be a leader. Leadership can come from anywhere. It's about the fight and the spirit in you. And that's the inspiration that is already bearing fruit right now.
Thank you. Ms. Gazi singa ga ugu ngeluthi laphana uphume kulolu hlelo ungasitshela nje ngama feature nje kusikhatshana sincane ukuthi kuyini ongakuchiyela abanye abatsha bangafuna ukuthi labo babe bengena kuhlelo olufana nalolu.
Okay, ngiyabonga. Mina engakuchiyela abantu abangafuna ukubuya labo be participate ku program leyo ukuthi bengisabeli khatshana. Beqale bezame, kungangcono behluleke bezamile. Akumelanga ukuthi behle bezitshela ukuthi bona abaqualify. Kumele bezame. As long as iminyaka iphakathi kwe-25 le-35, kumele ekalezame because isikhathi lesi opportunity le esibelayo it was very empowering and even lami nje mbuyela khona ngale ngizafika ngibatshela ngiba encourage ngo September ma applications nxa evula ukuthi be apply.
Thank you.
Ngibancedise labafuna ukuncedisa.
Thank you so much for coming on the show, Miss Kazi and Miss Mlingwa. Tsoka kwa uri Miss Muzangwa. We realize kuti Mandela Washington Fellowship inotora vanhu 700 per year, the whole of Africa, and mostly in Zimbabwe, 42 or 43 per year.
Yeah.
Avasi vese vachauya kuno. Mm-hmm. Experience yawawana muno. Ichabatsira vamwe ohere vari kumusha vasingawane mukana wekuti vange vachiuyawo under such programs.
Yes, definitely. Experience ichabatsira in the sense that generally I'm just an activator. I'm an activator. That was part of the Clifton strengths that we did here. I realized, yes, I'm an activator. So generally, people who associate with me will be filled with all that energy to want to apply. And also, you know, it will be easy for me to tell them and share with them what we learned here. So definitely, I am willing to assist those that want to come here, as I was assisted myself. So it has been an awesome experience, and I really, you know, on behalf of the Zimbabweans, even that were at Purdue, Tawanda Chiamba, Claire Makiana, and, you know, my coaches, Dan Dolls, I'm just grateful. And I know that whatever they have instilled in me, I will be able to pass it on to the next generation. Thank you.
Thank you so much. Let me take this opportunity to thank the four brilliant minds that we had today. These are Mandela Washington Fellows 2024 under the program Young African Leaders Initiative. They are here in the U.S. in Washington, D.C., for a summit that started yesterday and that will be concluded tomorrow. And on Thursday, some of them will be leaving to go into Africa to change the world, to go back to Zimbabwe to change the world. Thank you so much for coming on the program.
Thank you very much for having me.
Thank you, Zimbabwe, for watching today. Let me take this opportunity kuti ndikutendei mese vauya muchirongwa chedu chanhasi. Ngibonga kakhulu kuti lingenile kuhlelo lethu lwanamhlanje. Kodwa isikhathi yiso esuke sabaleka ke. Akusela sikhathi sesilugqiba ke lapha uhlelo lethu lwanamhlanje. That brings us to the end of our show. Signing off in Washington, I am Thabo Kancube.